Hello and welcome to this session. In our earlier sessions, we have talked about the methodology to be followed for systems analysis or system investigation. Now, what we have emphasized in our earlier sessions is that asking questions and fact-finding is the key to correct and complete systems analysis. But that is not enough. Just getting the facts about an organization, about the users is not enough. What you have to do is to sift through those facts and retain the relevant facts. That is a very important point which many analysts ignore, or they think it's not very important, but it is. Because you will be flooded otherwise with such a volume of data that you will not know what to keep and what not to keep. Now, let's think about something. You might be thinking that talking to users or getting information about the system from the users is a very straightforward job. After all, you're going to talk to the users who are experts in their own fields, who have been working in that particular department for some time. They should be knowing everything about the department and its working, and they should be able to give you the complete picture. Now, it is a sad but true fact that in theory, this may very well be true, but in actual practice, getting information out of users, getting information about a system, is like panning for gold. You have to go through a lot of sand, a lot of dirt, before you can get to a few grains of gold. So, after all, let's look at, is there any technique to fact-finding? Do you have to be organized to ask questions? Do you just go and, if you ask a question to the user, tell me everything about your department and it's working. Will that be enough? Well, there's definitely a technique to fact-finding. And in this session, we are going to be looking at some of the most commonly used techniques of fact-finding. The most commonly used techniques which we are going to look at are existing documentation, that is, the study of existing documentation, forms, files, and the records. We are going to look at research and site visits. We are going to look at observation of the work environment. Then we are going to look at questionnaires, interviews, and group sessions. Now, before we look at them one by one, let's just ask a question. Is there any right technique for fact-finding? No, there is no right technique, or there is no wrong technique. The correct approach is a judicious combination of these techniques. You can possibly use first one technique and then the other, combine the techniques, and that is the right approach. The sign of a good systems analyst is the correct choice of the techniques to use and the correct use of those techniques at the appropriate places. The sign of a good systems analyst is also an organized approach to systems analysis and to fact-finding. An inexperienced systems analyst will probably, what he will do is, from day one, go to the users. He will say the users are the most important things. They are the backbone, they are the key. It is for them that systems are made, and so we should get all the information from the users. Just find out what the users want, what his requirements are, what his needs are. Talk to the users, talk to them constantly, be with them all the time, get information from them. That's how it will work. Now, while it is true that users are important and that they are the bottom line, they are the people for whom systems are made, but users are also people working in an organization and they have their day-to-day work. If you decide that they are going to spend all their time with you answering your questions, then their work is going to suffer, and that is not going to make them very happy. Time is money. And if you are going to waste the user's time on your work, then the company is going to lose money. What you have to make sure is that you spend quality time with the users and not quantity time. How do you go about it? Let's consider a possible strategy. The first step in such a strategy would be to get all possible information you can from existing documentation. Now, it will surprise you to know that you can get a lot of information by looking at files, folders, any paperwork, minutes of the meetings or any study reports, anything from the system that you can get. You can get a lot of information for that, and you don't have to bother the user while doing it. The next step which you can look at is to observe the system in action. Now, this is of course only if it is possible, if it is feasible. If it is possible, then make sure that you stand there quietly in one corner. Don't ask any questions. Don't talk at all. Don't make the user aware that he is being observed. Just write down all what you observe, all what you think, what your doubts are, what your queries are. Write them all down on a piece of paper. Make sure, as I said, the user is not aware of you. He will be aware of you, but at least make sure that he knows you are not evaluating him, because otherwise, he is going to be subject to the Hawthorne effect. Do you know what the Hawthorne effect is? Wait, we'll talk about it later on in the session. So the next step is to observe the system in action. Now, after these two stages, what you have got a lot of information. Now, you can collate that information, you can collect that information, and by then you also will have pinpointed some of your basic doubts, some of your basic queries. You can then design questionnaires to clear up these basic doubts or these basic queries. Now, these questionnaires, remember, are designed by you, and this is the first interaction that you're going to have with the users. However, it is up to the user to decide when he's going to give you the time and how much of time he's going to give you. He may not even talk to you directly. You may drop off the questionnaire at his office. He will fill it up or answer it whenever he wants, whatever time is convenient to him, and go back to you. So you are talking to the user, yes, but again, as per the user's guidelines, not yours. After the questionnaires have been received back from the users, and after the answers have been analyzed, have been digested by you, you will have a very good idea about the system. You will also know what the possible problems are. You will also know what are the issues, the critical issues, which you still haven't understood. Now, these issues obviously are going to be not very large in number. The routine or the mundane issues will already have been discussed and analyzed by you. You are looking at paperwork by talking to users through questionnaires. So, what you are left with are the key issues, the critical issues. And this is the stage when you go and you make appointments with the users and talk to them face to face and discuss these key issues with them. You see the strategy that we have done? What we have done is we have taken care of all the regular and the normal routine jobs by looking at various things which are not involved with the user. You look at paperwork, you look at, observe the work environment, you get most of your other information out. For the critical areas, for that, you go to the users. So obviously your time which you spend with the users is limited, the user is happy, and so are you. After saying this, and after looking at this strategy, you must remember this is only a possible strategy. Each project is unique. Each project is different. And therefore, the strategy which you have to develop for each project would also necessarily be different. The point I'm trying to make out here is that there has to be a strategy. There has to be an organized approach for fact-finding. And as far as possible, your strategy should be such that you get most of the information from existing documentation, from observation, from any other source of information which does not involve the users too much. Try to make sure that your involvement with the users is only at the later stage and only in the critical stage. Now, let's look at the individual fact-finding techniques. The first fact-finding technique we're going to look at is the study of existing documentation. You may say, we are anyway going to give them a new system, so what is the point of studying the old one? As we have mentioned time and again in our earlier sessions, any study of the new system cannot be done without understanding the old system. You have to first understand what is happening currently, only then can you build on it or change it to develop the new system. So, existing documentation is absolutely essential. You have to study the documents which are being generated in the system, and to do that properly, what we suggest is you prepare a document department grid. What is this document department grid? Let's see in this example out here. On the vertical side, the y-axis, you have the various departments, which is sales, stores, purchase and finance. On the horizontal line, that is the x-axis, you have the various documents. Right now, given number names as A, B, C, D. These could be invoices, this could be your purchase orders, it could be store receipt, anything. In the grid which is formed, the numbers out there indicate the number of copies of each document to be sent to the departments. In this example, two copies of document A are sent to the sales department, one copy of document A is sent to the stores department, two copies of document A are sent to the finance, and nothing of document A is sent to the purchase department. One copy each of document B is sent to sales, stores, purchase and finance department. Now, after getting this grid in place, you will have an idea that all the documents which are flowing across the system, you'll have an idea about which document is going where, and then you can go to the destination departments and find out exactly how they're using those documents. For example, you can go to the storage department and ask them, are they really using those two documents which are coming to them? If they are, then how exactly are they using them? So, you see, this is a very important tool for you to understand clearly and also make the user understand, for the user to analyze how exactly this paperwork is moving in his department. What are the advantages of the study of existing documentation? Well, the most important advantage is that there is no need to disturb the user in his office. You can take all the documentation, you can take all the paperwork and sit in an empty office or sit in your own room and study everything without bothering the user at all. There is no time constraint. Now, this does not mean that you can take 3 months to study the existing documentation. What this only means is that there is no time deadline as you have in an interview. If you spend 2 or 3 hours in interviewing a user, then you are going to have one unhappy user at the end of it. Whereas, if you spend 2 or 3 hours in studying your paperwork or documents, it's fine, you haven't bothered anybody, you probably have a lot of information out of it. The next advantage is, you know exactly what is happening in the system and not what the user wants you to know. The paper which you have out there puts everything down in black and white. This is exactly what is happening. There is no user bias. There is no user's personal opinion to influence your thinking. You get an impartial view which is free from, as we said, any user's personal opinion, any personal inclinations that he might have, any office politics. So you get away from all that and get an impartial view. That is a major advantage of studying the existing documentation. We have talked about studying of documents. Now, what are the documents which you should study? The first and the most important, which we have talked about earlier, go back to the first session. We have talked about a document there. What is that? The organizational chart. That is the most important document in any organization, and your starting point should be that. Then you can look at inter-office memos, you can look at study reports, you can look at accounting records, you can look at policy manuals. Now, policy manuals are important because they will tell you how they are going to, they'll also tell you how, what are the constraints, what are the limitations which may be imposed on you when you prepare the proposed system. So, policy manuals are important. You can also look at the standard operating procedures or the SOPs, the job descriptions or the task descriptions for day-to-day operations, day-to-day work. You can look at the completed forms that represent actual transactions. You can look at manual as well as computerized reports. Remember, manual reports are also very important. You can look at documentation from previous studies. For example, this could be data dictionaries, this could be the data flow diagrams, they could be system documentation, program documentation, could be user manuals, could be training manuals, system manuals, anything. You can look at all that. Now, we can't go through each one of these in detail, but we are going to look at some of the important documents which we have noted down so far and study them in detail. And the organizational chart, as we mentioned before, is a very important document, but we have already talked about it in the earlier session, so we will not go into that right now. The next important document we are going to look at is completed forms. Now, you must remember here that only completed forms should be picked up. No blank forms should be taken. Now, it is important that we emphasize this because most of the time when the users ask for any form, what they do is tear out the sheet of paper from the back of the register and give it to you, a blank piece of paper. The problem with that is that that particular form may be an obsolete form. The form design may be obsolete. The user may have prepared his own design within the framework of that design, of that printed form, and may be using his own design rather than the printed form design. You will not know anything about that. Secondly, the column headings may be totally misleading. The user may have something else written on top of the column and he may be filling in something totally different inside the column. For example, once we were doing a study for a particular organization and then we picked up this form and we saw that one of the forms, the heading on the column was signature, whereas what the user had actually written in that form, in that column, was date and time. If we had taken the blank form from him, we would have thought that the information which is required is signature, whereas in reality, the information which would really be required was date and time. So remember, no blank forms at all. You must take completed forms. But how many forms should you take? Should you take one form? Should you take 10 forms, 100 forms, 1000 forms, 10,000 forms? What is the kind of sample that you need to make sure that you have taken a representative of the population? So what is your sample size? How do you calculate it? You use normal statistical techniques. The most commonly used formula, sample size is equal to 0.25 into the certainty factor divided by the acceptable error raised to the power of 2. What is the certainty factor? Now, this is something which is commonly available in most industrial engineering textbooks. It's a table. A part of the table is reproduced out here. This tells you if you want a desired certainty of 95%, then the certainty factor which you should use is 1.960. If you want a certainty of 90%, which means if you want to be 90% certain that the sample you select will be a true representative, it will take care of all the processing conditions, all the exceptions, and will not have any unsampled variations. If you want to be 90% certain of that, then the certainty factor is 1.645. So, if you want to be 90% certain that your sample is correct, it is absolutely true to the population, how do you get the sample size? The sample size then will be calculated as 0.25 into 1.645, which is the certainty factor for 90% certainty, divided by 0.10, which is the acceptable error. Now, if you have want to be 90% certain, obviously, you are ready to accept a 10% of error. So, divided by 0.10 raised to 2, the answer is 68. What that means is that out of the population, you should choose about 68 documents to get you a true representative of the sample. You have said you should choose 68 documents, but how should you choose them? What is the method you should use? There are two ways. The first one is randomization. You pick out any 68 documents that you want. Just close your eyes and put your finger or anything and pick that up, 68 of them. The second way is stratification, which is a more systematic way. In that, what you do is, you pick out, for using the same example that we have earlier, you pick out every 3,676 document. Why that? If you have a population of 25,000, say, you want a sample size of 68. Therefore, 25,000 divided by 68 is equal to 3,676. So, you pick out every 3,676 document, at the end of which you will have 68 documents as your sample. So, these are the ways you can find out of the sample and choose it. This was as far as the existing documentation, one of them, except the complete forms was concerned. The next documentation type we look at is reports. As we mentioned earlier, you should look at both manual as well as computerized reports. In addition, you must also look at all the personal reports. What are these personal reports? Personal reports are those reports which the user prepares either by hand, manually, or he word processes it using some information from the existing system. These reports are used by the user for his own use, maybe for statistical analysis or for answering questions from top management. They are his reports. Again, as remember, in our earlier session, we talked about this personal notebook or diary or register which is maintained by the user with information for decision making. These reports are something similar to that. Again, as we mentioned earlier, you have to be very tactful and be very aggressive to some extent to get these reports out of the user, because he will feel that is his property, it is not part of the system, so why should you ask for them? He might also feel that management will frown upon this because it's an irregular practice. But in spite of that, you have to get those reports out, because those are the true reports. You may even want to incorporate those reports into the new proposed system. That is as far as reports go. The next thing to look at is standard operating procedures or SOPs. Now, if the SOPs are in place in an organization, it makes life very much easier for a systems analyst, because then SOPs tell you exactly how things ought to be done. Then you can match it against how things are being done right now in the organization and see where the mismatches or the gaps, discrepancies lie. In case the SOPs are not prepared or not existing in an organization, then it's up to the systems analyst to prepare them. For that, he has to talk to the relevant users, he has to see the kind of activities they are carrying out, what are the responsibilities, and then prepare the SOPs. A clear, complete and accurate SOP has to be prepared. Once you have a complete and accurate SOP, either prepared by the analyst or existing from the organization, you can then match it with the actual procedures being carried out and see the mismatches. What are the kind of mismatches that you can come up with? Well, it could be a duplicate information, which means that you have the same information flowing in different ways in the organization. You might have a procedure actually eliminated in actual practice, which should technically be there and which should be performed as per the SOP. You might have the same form with different types of information entered on it. Let me give you examples. Let's say you have the sales from the customers of the northern zone shown to you in one form, in one type of form, and the sales from the customers in the southern zone in a different type of form. You ask the user, why is there a disparity? Why is there a difference? In many cases, the user might say, well, we don't know. That's the way it's always been done, and so we continue doing it. Or you might discover that in one purchase order, the quantity indented is also printed. In another purchase order, it is not printed. Again, no explanation. It is up to you to find out these mismatches, these gaps, identify them, review them, and resolve them with the help of the users. This is as far as the existing documentation is concerned. Now let's look at the next fact-finding technique, which is research and site visits. Now this is not a very commonly used technique because it is not very relevant to commercial aspects. However, here we'll talk about research. Research in this case means a study of the application and its problem areas. Now you can do this research, you can do this study by going through trade journals, by going through libraries, reference rooms. You can talk to other companies, you can talk to departments in other companies who are probably or may be facing the same problems that you are facing. You can talk to them to find out if there is any tool, manual or computerized, that can help you in solving these problems. So you basically have to talk to a lot of people to find out if they have any solutions, if they have any suggestions to offer. The last technique we are going to look at in this session is observation of the work environment. which means an actual watching of the processes which take place in an organization and the users who are actually doing those processes. This is not a very commonly used technique. Can you think why? It is because, firstly, to impress the systems analyst, many times the users display only simple or routine work, something which they know they can do very well, and probably the analyst might get impressed by it. So they display only routine, simple work, result of which the analyst is not able to really judge what is happening in the system. He's not able to see the complex part. He's not able to see the non-standard, non-routine part. Second point, in some cases, the analyst might find it difficult to observe the work area because of either too many interruptions coming in or because of inconvenient shifts. For example, the graveyard shift, which means the night shift. Also, again, to impress the systems analyst, in some cases, the users might decide to perform a particular job correctly, temporarily, whereas in actual practice, he may be doing it incorrectly. But just for now, again, because the analyst is watching him, he may perform it correctly, giving the analyst a totally wrong picture. The last point is that people on stage are definitely different from what they are in real life. So if somebody knows that an analyst is observing him, he becomes aware of it and subconsciously performs better. That is the Hawthorne effect. The Hawthorne effect can be defined as the reward you reap when you pay attention to people. Now, just the mere fact of you paying attention to someone spurs them into doing better. For example, suppose you have a management trainee and you take the trainee out and you decide to give her some extra managerial skills, send her to training classes to give her extra managerial skills. Without saying anything, what you have indicated to the trainee is that you feel she is valuable to the organization, you feel that she is important, and you are willing to spend time and money to enhance her skills. The trainee then feels that she is on the road to the top, she feels important enough, she feels valuable enough, and that fact motivates her to do better. Now, this motivation is totally apart from what skills she may have gathered from her training sessions. That is different. The mere fact that you feel she is important enough makes her do better. This is the Hawthorne effect. The fact that they feel someone upstairs is caring about them and therefore making them do better. That is the Hawthorne effect. Which is why some people, some analysts feel that observation is not the right technique, because they say if an analyst is observing a user, automatically because of the Hawthorne effect, the user is going to perform better. So the observation is not a true observation. Some people say that there's an argument going on. It could be true, may not be true. However, there are some benefits to observation. The benefits are, the advantages are, you can see exactly what is going on in the system, because sometimes users find it difficult to explain some complex procedure. Maybe you are not, the analyst is not able to understand, because after all he is a layman, he does not understand much about the industry which he is studying. The user may not be able to explain very well. So the best thing to do is to actually see it happening, see it being done, and that gives you a pretty good idea about the complex procedure. Second thing is that there may be some physical conditions which are affecting the work being done, which may not come about, this particular discussion may not come about when the user is talking to the analyst face to face. For example, if you have excessive heat or excessive noise or there is a lack of space, things like that which are going to affect the user and his working, and these things can be apparent to the analyst only if he goes and stands there and observes what is exactly happening. These are main advantages. What you have to be sure when you are doing observation is that you have to be prepared. You have to make sure that you observe the user and his work during normal hours and also during the peak hours. You have to make sure that you have data collection forms ready. These data collection forms could either be designed by you or they could be pre-designed by the company. So have those forms ready and document all what you have discovered, all what you have observed in those data collection forms. You must make sure that you are documenting it immediately. Don't wait and say, okay, let me go back to the office and then I'll remember and write it down. When you go back to the office, you'll have phone calls to answer, you'll have people coming in, and you'll forget what you have actually observed, what you have thought of at that time. So make sure you document it then and there, immediately. Discount any textbook procedures. Again, as we have mentioned before, to impress the analyst, some of the users might decide to display some textbook procedures, which means that they do something according to the book, exactly as per the book, and that's the analyst might feel that that's the way they do it all the time, but discount that. Make sure that you don't make any assumptions, because if you make assumptions, or at least make sure that you are able to substantiate them. Make sure that you review and verify any conclusions that you have reached. You should review them, you should verify them with the appropriate people at the appropriate time, make sure all that is done, and only then do you accept the conclusions as final. To summarize, what we have looked at in this session is we have looked at a possible strategy for fact finding. We have also seen that this strategy is just a possible one. It is just a sample, it is just a pointer. But the main thing to remember is that whatever project you are working in, a strategy is important. An organized method, an organized way of looking at it is very important. The strategy should hopefully try to get you all the information as far as possible from sources other than the users. Keep the users, keep your interaction with the users to a minimum, and only talk to them about the critical issues, the key issues. We have looked at in detail three different fact-finding techniques. The first one is study of existing documentation, second one research and site visits, and the third one observation of the work area. In the next session, we are going to be looking at questionnaires and interviews. Thank you very much.